New York Zeitgeist group. I'm just going to quickly introduce the anarcho-capitalists and then hand it over to the Zeitgeist guys to introduce them and tell you a little bit about what's going on. So on the right, we have Anders Mikkelsen. He's a frequent author of articles on economics, history, and ethics and politics. And on the left, we have Todd Seavey, who is the author of the new book, Libertarianism for Beginners.
And I'll have some of those for sale after.
All right, and my name is Mike Havoc. I'm a chapter coordinator for the New York City Zeitgeist Movement. I'm going to introduce the con side of the motion for tonight. Here we have Harry Cason. He is a professor of political science at the College of Staten Island City University of New York, as well as chapter coordinator with myself for the Zeitgeist Movement New York City. To his right, we have Mark Horowitz, a teacher of sociology at Seton Hall University, and is published in such journals as Critical Sociology, Sociological Spectrum, and the Journal of Borderlands Studies regarding various issues on social justice movements, human nature, and the long-term sustainability of capitalism. And we wanted to ask you guys a question tonight just to take a temperature reading of the audience. How many agree with the resolution tonight that market capitalism is as good as it gets? Can I see a show of hands, please? All right. And those opposed to the motion? Okay, so it looks like free market capitalists have it right now. We'll see how that changes for the rest of the night. So I guess you guys are ready to begin?
All right.
Okay.
All right. I'm going to go first presenting a vision.
Yeah.
It's like, yes, we must speak. We must speak loudly, especially for the camera.
Oh, yeah, and as a veteran TV producer, just a reminder, don't look directly into the camera. It looks terrible. So, I would contend, as one of the anarcho-capitalists up here, that capitalism has done more to make people free, prosperous, and happy than any other social system that has existed. And without bogging down in terminology, as these sorts of debates sometimes do, I just should start out by saying that by capitalism, I mean, fundamentally, a system in which no individual uses your property, including your body, without your permission. That does not mean Anders or I defend everything ever done in any society vaguely considered capitalist, be it crime or corruption or other violations of its own rules. We're defending societies to the extent they are capitalist. With libertarianism being a more consistent adherence than we see in most societies to the legal rule of non-interference with body or property. And so-called anarcho-capitalism, like anarchist and capitalism, then being the ideal scenario from our perspective, property rights conventions prevailing, including private courts and private police, with no government at all. That's what I'm pushing for. But I will try, for purposes of the debate, to use the broader and certainly shorter term capitalism to refer to the general direction I'm trying to push policies, whether we make it all the way there or not. As an aside, I should say that both libertarianism and the Zeitgeist movement, with which my debate opponents are affiliated, have sometimes spawned conspiracy theorists, as have all political factions at one time or another. But those views are tangential to the core economic issues we're debating and probably won't even come up at all tonight. I just mentioned that in passing in case that disappoints or surprises anyone. Sorry. Anyway, I would contend, back on the main topic, that it's not a coincidence that capitalism does such a great job of delivering the goods, literally, and keeping most people happy most of the time, relative to other systems. It is, after all, built fundamentally on the recognition that there are 7 billion people on the planet, 7 billion individuals, and each of those people, just like you, has a different set of preferences. Capitalism, then, despite the way it gets lumped in with stodgy conservatism in some people's minds, is the recognition of diversity. We have similarities, but even experts disagree. impassioned, committed social theorists have different ways they want to do things. People starting communes don't want to do it the same way. Even twins have divergent tastes about music and literature and the like. In short, if you were trying to sum up the human race, there is no consensus, and there's not going to be, ever. Even a fairly simple attempt to buy music on a as a collective on a seemingly homogeneous college campus would quickly yield unhappy results if you actually thought you were going to get everybody to roughly agree on which song to listen to next. That's why we've rapidly seen in the past couple of decades people listening to their own music more and more frequently. In fact, I mean, I've been on a college campus where I thought, hey, everybody here has tastes somewhat like mine. They're just as hip as I am. They probably like the same cool alternative rock bands I do. And then you actually take a vote, and I'm telling you, you're going to end up with Frank Sinatra or Britney Spears as the default album if you try to get everybody to agree, because that's the kind of terrible outcome you get when you try to get a big collective consensus on how to do things. You don't want that. Imagine, even within a relatively homogenous group that knows each other really well, like a family, a nuclear family living in one small house. I mean, how often do they even want to all make the same weekend plan together? Do they all want to go to the same amusement park? Sometimes, not always. Instinct, unfortunately, tells us to take comfort in groups and solidarity and unity and trying to do things through togetherness. But that's not how progress and innovation and happiness happen. Have you never seen a group making a terrible mistake attached to the wrong consensus and thought, thank goodness I have the freedom to exit as an individual and do my own thing? The key to social and intellectual progress is the ability to exit, to escape, to get away from those idiots doing it the wrong way, not unanimity. Can millennials, in particular, of which there appear to be a few here, even imagine being told there will be one phone company, but fear not, because it'll be the best phone company, and it'll be planned by experts with lots of input from everybody? No, you just want to be able to escape and go your own way. I will say, the Zeitgeist movement is admirably committed to rationality and progress, and at times resembles my own skeptical movement and Hayekian intellectual foundations. Those are a pro-science and a pro-market movement. But again, consensus isn't how things work. Consider the more competitive piecemeal models of real science and market evolution, which happen through individuals coming up with and testing new ideas, even if everybody tells them that's not the way it works. And with that thought, I'll hand things over to Anders.
Thank you. So, yes, we're looking forward to discussing this, and a lot of you have gotten the outline of the Zeitgeist argument, and I'd like to note that those who are familiar with anarcho-capitalism ideas will recognize that there are some misconceptions about what anarcho-capitalism is. And so hopefully we'll have a chance to talk about what some of those are. And to augment what Todd was saying, I believe that both of us believe in a free society and a peaceful society, and we both agree that those are good things. And so we have a lot of similarities there. And so we can help help people by adopt the capitalist ideas. So one of the big things is that we have a vision of a peaceful free society, which allows free enterprise, which means for-profit but also non-profit cooperation. So it allows people to cooperate together, and especially with strangers, people who we don't necessarily know very well, or people on the other side of the world, people who aren't related to us. And a big part of this will be private property, and this is something which people naturally adopt in a free society. And private property also helps resolve and minimize conflicts, and similarly, a society which wants to minimize conflicts will have private property. And going along with that, as Mises pointed out, under a classical liberal society, both the individual and society are not in conflict. They're not inherent conflicts between the two. Unfortunately, in other systems, there are conflicts which people who've read a lot of history are very familiar with. Anarcho-capitalism is what free people will do in a free society. And we do agree that there are economic problems today, but we place the blame for all those problems firmly where they belong, on the state. And we also do not believe that the state is a moral or practical means of helping resolve society's problems, and I think that the Zeitgeist movement agrees with that. We do differ on a couple of big areas, one of which is scarcity. We believe that scarcity is real. So your time is limited. You guys don't have enough time on a Friday night to do all the things you could do. You had to make a choice. You chose to come here, and you chose not to go somewhere else. So you don't have unlimited time to do anything. And from that basic fact follows a lot of the other facts of scarcity, including material goods. And similarly, in a free society, there will be exchange. People will cooperate, and they'll want to exchange goods and services. And in order to do that, people will try barter, but people find that they like to have a medium of exchange. So anarcho-capitalists believe that, I've seen, in fact, that a free people will come up with the idea of money and will use money as a medium of exchange, and money is a medium of exchange, and vice versa. And this allows people to cooperate, and similarly, prices, the existence of prices, allows coordination, allows social coordination among people. And it also helps make decisions. And so if someone is a good Samaritan and they wanted to provide as many shirts to or clothing to poor people as possible, they would still want to have prices so that they could make that clothing as efficiently as possible and with as few wasted resources. And prices are essential for that process. And as has been shown by Mises and others, without prices and money, economic chaos ensues, and it's unfortunately inevitable and cannot be avoided. So in short, a free society enables innovation, and with innovation, that creates qualitative leaps in wealth, which is extremely important. It escapes diminishing returns. It's not just quantitative wealth, it's also qualitative leaps. And with a free society of private property and free enterprise, we have seen over the last few hundred years, especially since 1800, a great increase in wealth for all the peoples of the world who have adopted or moved towards an anarcho-capitalist vision. And so there are now billions of people who have moved out of poverty because their societies have allowed people to have free enterprise.
Okay, great. Unlike the anarcho-capitalist side, Harry and I aren't as eloquent without notes, so I'm going to be reading a bit. I'm going to start off with some core principles and then we'll shift back and forth. We're here today to propose that the principles of a post-scarcity or a resource-based economy are far superior to anarcho-capitalism from the standpoint of human flourishing and freedom. We're not arguing that a post-scarcity economy is inevitable, that it'll be void of any problems, or that it'll be easy to be achieved. We're certainly not arguing that. But we do believe it's possible and desirable to work toward that system. So we consider the question of how to transition it to it to be quite complex and difficult with no easy answers. Perhaps we'll address that a little later tonight. But the basic outline I distributed earlier, I hope most of you have at least had a chance to, if you've already read it, maybe pass it on to people near you and then have a chance to read it. So let's hit on the key principles that we'll be touching on now. So we're going to be elaborating these points. Point number one. Capitalist economic system is in crisis. Alarm regarding economic and ecological problems is widespread today. We have observers pointing to an array of troubling realities and prospects, such as unsustainable levels of inequality, systemic crisis, ecological problems, and climate change, just to name a few major ones. Bad news abounds. According to a recent Oxfam report, the richest 62 people in the world now own about the same real wealth as the bottom 3.5 billion people, or half the world's population. 58% of all wildlife has disappeared in the world in the last four decades. More than half of the world's people live in countries that are over pumping their aquifers. Even the elite World Economic Forum in 2013 warned of multiple what they call troubling trends on the horizon, such as widening income disparities, persistent structural unemployment, and inaction on climate change.
Our second point, technological developments could be liberating, yet under capitalism, they are our enemy. Workers worry whether their job will be automated, which they increasingly are. As evidence of automation has reduced the need for industrial labor dramatically and increasingly even service sector work. as David Rotman explains in the Journal of MIT Technology Review, at least since the 1980s, computers have increasingly taken over such tasks as bookkeeping, clerical work, repetitive production jobs in manufacturing, all of which are typically middle-class paying jobs. At the same time, high-paying jobs requiring creativity and problem-solving skills, often aided by computers, have proliferated. The result has been a polarization of the workforce and a hollowing out of the middle class, something that has been happening in numerous industrial countries for the last several decades. Likewise, the proportion of Americans employed in manufacturing has dropped from 30% in the post-World War II years to 10% today, partly because of increasing automation, especially during the 1980s. The ongoing economic anxieties are rationalized by conventional economists as market adjustments that hurt some workers, but in the end benefit the economy as a whole. I think we've already heard that so far. Yet, in the last two decades, we continue to see a decoupling of productivity and job growth, a new phenomenon linked to automation. Indeed, robotization is expected to eliminate 6% of all U.S. jobs in the next 5 years, and the trend will no doubt continue. The Zeitgeist vision is based on conscious cooperation, resource management, planning, and the declaration of our natural resources and social wealth as the common heritage of all life. It will be our future if we are to have one. Such a revolutionary vision is hard to imagine, but it becomes possible when large numbers of individuals come to recognize the incredible advantage of cooperation over competition in the realm of economics and in the general welfare. In this area of economics, we need to work together to manage our resources and to enhance production and distribution. Otherwise, we continue to wastefully destroy and consume our resources, competitively fighting wars over our resources. We, in fact, have the capacity to produce general abundance given technological developments, hence what we call the post-scarcity society and economy. But we cannot achieve sustainable distribution of that potential abundance under modern capitalism due to its competitive nature. Emmanuel Saez of UC Berkeley has pointed out that the top 1% saw their real incomes grow by 34.7% between the years 2009 and 2012, while the bottom 99% only saw a 0.8% gain. Furthermore, Thomas Piketty, in his book Capital, has clearly demonstrated that competitive capitalism over the long periods does not disperse power or wealth, but instead creates oligopolies. Piketty advocates redistributive taxation as a solution, but in our view, that is wholly inadequate, a wholly inadequate solution that does not address the root structural problem we face. We, the Zeitgeist Movement, call for a cooperative system. The incentive under such social relations is now to cooperatively and technologically eliminate more and more of the necessary and unpleasant work, freeing us all to pursue higher order efforts in all areas of our life. In a resource-based economy, money would become a thing of the past, and so education, like everything else, would be freely available to everyone to enhance one's personal, technical, and intellectual growth. The question will no longer be, do we have the money to do something? It will instead be, do we have the resources? And do we ever? We have computerization, artificial intelligence, nanotechnology, 3D printers, make all of these things possible. With technology now doing much, if not most, of the necessary work, people could finally be genuinely free for the first time in human history. We would have the time to govern ourselves through direct democracy and open source computing. Under this, direct democracy is so important. Under this system, economic oligopolies and private corporation will have no reason for being. Access to resources will be made available to all localities on the basis of social needs, freeing production and distribution from market inequalities, corporate ownership, and competition that corrodes, terribly corrodes social relations, between individuals. Accordingly, individuals will be free to give their best effort, and nothing will stand in their way from doing so. In conjunction, necessary labor will be shared, rotated, and reduced to a minimum. Localities will produce as much as possible for themselves and will determine their particular cooperatively based economic and cultural design using science as much as possible to guide their development.
I'm going to have to do a little bit of speed reading to keep this in 2 minutes, but try to follow if you can. In our view, ANCAP's vision is what we would view as ahistorical and unrealistic. Many of you in this room may feel Zeitgeist's vision is that, but we feel the anarcho-capitalist vision is much more so. An anarcho-capitalist vision based on private ownership, competition, and commodity exchange fails to understand fundamentally basic aspects of capitalist development, which is that free markets tend to become unfree as individual proprietors amass into larger and larger entities, look around you, and with an eye to dominating market share and shaping government decisions in their interest. To expect people to trade their products freely when large economic units are able to undersell any viable competitor is naive. How many of us are going to take out a loan and start a new aeronautics business or a new automobile industry? As alluded to above, ANCAP fails to understand that the ultimate source of profits under capitalism is the collective labor power of workers. And yet, the competitive dynamics of capitalism and the need for technological change to survive in the market continues to eliminate labor. As a result, the necessary purchasing power of the general public to buy the oversupply of commodities is undermined. States, historically, and banks have come in through credit to try to deal with this problem. What do we have? Rising public and private debts. We're still in the shadow of the 2008 mortgage crisis. In the meantime, the ecological crises based on a corporate-dominated industrial system deepen. The voices of scientists are basically just ignored because they're not profitable. Powerful corporations and their sympathetic politicians whom they fund support the process. We need serious coordinated action. It will not be easy. We have to protect liberty and flourishing in the process. But the ANCAP vision, abstract and divorced from these things, wholly inadequate to deal with those ecological issues. Finally, the vision is sociologically naive. They argue for a society free of coercion that's wholly voluntary, yet they fail to understand that decisions can be voluntary but completely unfree. To give the most obvious example, thousands of migrants each year in countries like Mexico, Malaysia, China, and Senegal migrate to export platforms. They're working for pennies an hour. That's not a testament to their freedom. That's a testament to the oppressiveness of their social conditions. Perhaps during the questions, I may be able to sneak in a little bit more of our opening statement. Okay, great. I think it's...
Okay, so who's going first?
Andrew's going to ask you questions.
All right. Okay, so we agreed that we would try to hold a conversation at this point, asking questions of each other.
Okay. And, well, first thing I want to say is that I believe Todd and I did not come here to praise the existing status system or at all. We came here to bury it. So I want to get that out of the way. And there's a lot of good points here in this, but there's also a lot of stuff where the anarcho-capitalist point of view is not what's on this piece of paper. And there are lots of refutations and lots of, you know, big books you can read. And even by books like Bourgeois Dignity, which are not by a total anarcho-capitalist, which you can also read, which will basically blows all this stuff out of the water. And so we're not here to really, we thought that we were here to discuss market capitalism, not the existing system. So I think that's fair to say, right?
Well, I was trying to make it sound like a spectrum.
Okay, right. But we do think that as a society moves towards market capitalism, we have seen historically, and it's very true, that there has been progress. So I wanted to kind of get that out of the way. But as far as discussing, one thing I was curious about with the Zeitgeist system was I was a little bit confused about the Zeitgeist conception of property and how things would work in a Zeitgeist society. And it seems to me that in a free society, let's say I have a bicycle and I want to go, and presumably bicycles would be okay in a Zeitgeist society. I would want to go from work to home and back. So let's say I go to work and there's my bicycle. And I'd like my bicycle to be there when I leave work so that I can ride it home. So how does this work in a Zeitgeist society? Because we couldn't tell what, if any, property rights there are.
Yes, really simply, things like this, cameras, bikes, a lot of things, not everything, but many, many things would be made available in a library-type setting, Kind of like the City Core group has made all these bicycles available, but you have to pay for them, right? Mm-hmm. Zeitgeist, we want to eliminate the need to have to pay for anything, really. And so those kinds of things would be easily available at your local library.
Okay. So there was a some things about sort of being divorced from reality, and I would like to get down to brass tacks as far as what about my bike, which I took to my work, and will it still be there when I got off of work? Because I think one of the things that causes conflict in society is if I take my bike to work and I walk outside and there's no bike, and how am I going to get home now? That causes conflict. I'm upset that my bike isn't there, that I don't have any way to get home. So according to you, there would be a library, but that's great. I don't want to walk to the library and get the bike. I would like to have my bike at work where I left it. Or I would like to know that somehow there will magically be a bike there for me to use.
Yeah, there would be, absolutely. Why wouldn't there be? Just as we need parking spaces for cars, there would be places for bikes easily available all around, assuming we have room for bikes on our highway. So,
okay, so what is, so is there a Zeitgeist vision saying, like, that it's my bike and therefore you can't take it, or is the Zeitgeist vision that you should just grab whatever you see and ride off with it?
Whatever bike is available is there. Now, we would always, Zeitgeist absolutely insists that if we're going to produce something, we produce it well. We produce it very well. So there will, quality bikes will be your will be all the bikes that are made. And that good quality bike of yours will be there. Even though it might not be the one you were sitting on when you rode in, it'll be virtually the same bike of quality.
So how would somebody who happens to walk by my workplace know not to take the last bike because I'm still at my desk and I would like to have the bike when I leave? How would somebody know not to take my bike?
Well, the assumption would be that there will be plenty of bikes around, and there will be subways. There will be, and again, it's not your bike. It's a bike that belongs to all of us, and it's available to all of us. But there will be subways. There will be taxis if necessary. There will be trains and all kinds of other ways if, for some reason, all the bikes were missing.
Right. So they're okay. So it does sound like there's nothing to prevent someone from just running off of the bike.
It could happen, but it would be doubtful. I don't understand. What would be the issue?
Well, I wouldn't have my bike, so I wouldn't have anything at home.
This is the thing. It's not your bike.
Exactly, that's the point.
Yes,
that's our point.
Yes, that's our point. We're gonna have audience participation in a little bit. So, but no, okay. The idea is that we're working together to see to it that the resources of the earth are available to all of us at the highest possible level.
Sure.
And I don't see any reason why all the bikes would have to be gone. But if it could possibly happen, there will be plenty of other avenues for you to get home.
Right. And my point is that it seems that we have a situation where somebody has seen to it that resource is not available to me because somebody has taken the bike and there's no ethical system or no rules telling the person, well, you know what, you probably shouldn't take that bike because there's a person who's depending on that bicycle to get home. So there's no way for them to know one way or the other based on how you talk about the Zeitgeist system, whereas in the case of the city bike system, it's obviously a little bit different. Everybody knows, the risks they're running, that there might not be a bike available, but everybody's sharing it. Our point of view, I believe, is that, correct me if I'm wrong, Todd, is that under a private property system, there are rules, and so therefore I know that it's my bike and somebody should ask if they want to use it, and that prevents conflict, and it means that I can plan ahead, and I know that I will be able to get home if everybody else follows the rules. Whereas it sounds like under this system, I have no way of knowing how I'm going to get home every day when I go to work.
Well, I think I've answered that question quite easily. There will be multiple ways to get home, and the chances of the of all bites being gone, a pretty would be slim. We would make that would be our job. As now, remember, we are going to be ruling over ourselves democratically, and that means all of us, direct democracy. And if you want a situation where we're constantly walking out of our jobs and we can't find any way home, then I think that we would correct that. It's really an incredibly minor problem or issue.
So this leads to the next step. So let's say that we democratically vote in our little neighborhood that the new rule will be that if you put your sticker on a bike, noting that you want it, so it will be available for you when you use it. Can we democratically vote that's okay, or just
if that's what we want? Yes.
Oh, okay. So that's good. So we can vote to have an institution of private property.
If that's yes, and we wouldn't have a Zeitgeist system, but we would have presumably a libertarian system. But yes, absolutely. If what people want, it will have to be determined. And now look, you say, should we vote for this thing? Well, you don't actually abide by the concept of voting, right? It's what I want that counts, not voting and determining, right, in the libertarian point of view.
It's not what I want at all. That's not the point. It's about free cooperation between individuals for mutual benefit.
Or could you turn the Zeitgeist system into a libertarian one, I guess?
Yeah.
And
absolutely, anybody who wants to participate in a Zeitgeist system is an anarcho-capitalist is more than welcome to do so, and in fact highly encouraged. So anybody who wants to join a monastery, do anything they want.
For sure. This has to be determined by what we want. Now, we are saying that we will be so much better off by working together. I just mentioned the fact that we fight an awful lot of wars, we kill a lot of people, we waste a lot of resources in order to get control of the very resources that we're fighting over.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a tremendous loss. And so we need to decide together whether what we're really going to do. And if we want to continue to fight over resources, which is that is the nature of competition. Competition, libertarian or capitalist system that you're coming up with, I haven't heard a whole lot of difference between. I know we haven't had a whole lot of time yet, but I haven't heard a lot of difference between your system and capitalism. So,
sure. Well, and again, our system is how you will avoid conflict and avoid fighting. So I think that's very important. And our contention is also that this is what once people understand how this stuff works, this is what basically people end up agreeing is the best system to follow because it's what they would naturally follow. So they will end up voting to basically have private property bicycles. So that's,
isn't the 10 minutes up?
So next,
our 10
next people
is up.
Yeah.
So we'll now turn it over to Todd and.
Now, at the expense of my own time, I'm just going to respond briefly also to what Anders had raised, maybe slightly modifying a bit Harry's position. In my view, there's nothing about a democratic Zeitgeist or resource-based economy that inhibits indefinite use of a bicycle, indefinite use of anything. The issue is not your own private use of a bicycle. It's that a factory that makes bicycles is no longer controlled by a tiny group of people driven to maximize gain regardless of the larger ecological and human costs. So sure, it's not a perfect world. We can concoct lots of philosophical experiments about how a certain circumstance may or may not lead. I mean, maybe libraries shouldn't work because everybody should be at the library now hoarding all the books. Yet it doesn't happen. Water fountains shouldn't work. We all should be filling them up for a rainy day. It's not happening. I guess a dry day for that matter. It's not happening. So there is reasonable grounds to believe that when we socialize large aspects of our economy, we can actually lead to a greater degree of human flourishing than the anarcho-capitalist vision suggests. Now, I know that Anders had said earlier that, well, I thought we were debating capitalism in some abstract sense, and the definition here is really interesting. A system in which no one uses your body or you without your permission. That is such a broad definition of capitalism. I was struggling, maybe Todd could address this. the vast majority of human history, we didn't have money, this institution that I believe they think is, if you don't have, all chaos will ensue. 99% of human history were hunting and gathering societies. They didn't have money, didn't have social classes. And these systems, which I'm not idealizing, I'm not saying we should go back to them, of course not. We're far, far beyond that. But they were egalitarian societies. And they were embedded in social norms of reciprocity. I suppose, and I don't think it's fair to ask Todd on Andrew's question here, but is that capitalism to them? 99% of human history prior to the rise of agriculture, you'd call capitalists because in those systems, people weren't controlled by other people? Or are the norms of those societies still coercive and you would call them something besides capitalism?
So as I'm defining it, you've got a capitalist system precisely to the extent that people don't violate others' property rights. So there were violations of capitalist norms the first time one caveman clonked another over the head and took his food, and presumably that happened almost from the beginning. So the vicious sociopathic impulse to socialize things, to be a socialist, to be a collective, has unfortunately been with us not only since the dawn of human history, but since before we even evolved, because creatures have always seen that one way they can get things is by, instead of trading, simply forcibly taking things from others. That's the way government does things, that's the way socialists do things, that's the way predatory animals do things. That's what you want to avoid. And you avoid that only by creating property rights rules so that people know, I can't ethically use that, I can't ethically use you. Or as Kant put it, not that he was a perfect libertarian.
My impulse is to intervene just because it's very interesting, but you have lots of time and your questions to be able to elaborate on your perspective. So, prehistoric societies were capitalist or were not capitalist in your view?
It would be ridiculous to say all of them were or all of them weren't. To the extent anyone, anywhere, abides by property rights, they're behaving like a capitalist. To the extent they violate them, they're not
behaving like
capitalists.
They didn't have classes, property, money. They had norms of reciprocity. Matter of fact, long history of evolutionary biology suggests that our higher social emotions, like compassion, gratitude, shame, if we take the meat for ourselves from the hunt, we will be excluded from the group. These were societies that distributed things and survived and endured in a way, which, by the way, certainly don't want to return to them, but they were, by any stretch, sustainable compared to what we're witnessing today.
And again,
were those not unfree in your view?
Virtually every society, from the most primitive to ours, has contained a mixture of capitalist behaviors and non-capitalist behaviors, as I've said a couple of times now. I'm not going to say it again. Basically, if you're taking stuff without the other person's permission, you're not behaving like a capitalist. If you're trading, you are behaving like one. So you can go back to 10,000 BC, or you can talk about 10,000 AD, you're probably going to find a mix of property rights abiding and non-property rights abiding behavior. I condemn the non-property rights abiding behavior. I praise the property rights abiding behavior. And furthermore, it's really important to point out that our social norms of reciprocity and humanitarian impulses have been greatly aided whenever there are clear rules. That thus the expression, good fences make good neighbors. When you've got a commons and nobody knows who it belongs to, that's when you get each person saying, maybe my shit needs
so
a little more grass
today.
I
feel it would be a little bit unfair to our side if we allowed too much of a filibuster. Mm-hmm. So let me ask another question. Very eloquent one, by the way. let me ask this. You gentlemen wanted to debate some abstract capitalism that's not coercive, but the actual history of capitalism, by all accounts, is one in which small proprietors got really, really big. Matter of fact, government, if we go back in history, didn't want corporations. So it's this big, bad, terrible state, and by the way, Harry and I do share the view that there are serious problems with state power, which we want to curb. We actually believe that a Zeitgeist economy is our best shot of reducing it. But that's a larger debate a little down the road. The actual history of capitalism is small proprietors joining together, putting pressure on states. Our neighboring state, New Jersey, actually was one of the ones that historically was one of the earliest to start loosening corporate rules so that more and more money could be aggregated. And lo and behold, once states started competing for investment, laws followed, corporations got bigger to where today they essentially dominate, I wouldn't say totally control, but they largely dominate the political process. They foster a public relations industry to narrow our public debates to extremely shallow questions that don't address our most severe social problems. So what is my question? My question is, what if you had your dream and wish of an anarcho-capitalist society, on what grounds do you believe it would not morph or grow into a corporate dominated system?
The biggest boon to corporate control was anti-capitalist philosophy. Basically, things went wrong and we developed a corporate-dominated economy about a century ago because largely of capital P progressives. They're the ones who said, oh, we don't want to leave everything to the chaos of the market, so we should have big firms partner with big government, and they'll have regulations that control what everyone does. It was collectivist thinking that basically led to the Federal Reserve, that led to fascism, that led to socialism, that led to corporations partnering, because people like Teddy Roosevelt and Woodrow Wilson, two different parties, but they both thought big business should partner with big government, and the tiny firms that I think we both sort of respect were crowded out of that picture. Take a practical example. I think like in the Zeitgeist Manifesto, it talks a little bit about the problem of regulatory capture. I'm all for discussing that, which is basically when large firms interact so much with regulatory agencies that they end up sort of taking them over. For one thing, that wouldn't happen if you didn't have the regulatory agencies to begin with, so you're creating a big juicy target for corporate takeover when you do that. But also, even if you've got well-meaning, sort of sociotropic, social democratic people thinking, how best should we regulate? If they've got a regulatory agency, they're going to look around and say, what are the best models? Ask the experts. This is often what Zeitgeist sounds like they want to do. Ask the experts what the model for regulation should be. They're going to look to the biggest, most established firms. If you had started regulating computers in a big way 40 years ago, IBM would be the model for everything, and you wouldn't have had little startups in garages and people doing things their own way, and Linux and Unix. You would have IBM saying, like, don't worry, we don't want any crazy chaotic startups happening. Here's how you do things. Here are the best practices. We want to have best practices, obviously. The last thing you want to do is create regulatory agencies capable of partnering with big businesses.
Many of you are anarcho-capitalists. You probably understand the subtleties of Todd's point better than I do. I got the impression he was arguing that huge corporate oligopolies were caused by social justice activists, essentially. And government advocating this. If I have a lemonade stand, and I'm working at my local park, since you gentlemen like these sort of disembodied philosophical experiment examples, I have my lemonade stand, and I'm in a park, and I'm really sweating my butt off to do it, and somebody opens up their lemonade stand across the street, the first thing I'm going to do, instead of working my butt off, I'm going to say, hey, Tony, Let's go meet and have a sandwich and let's talk about some prices and we're going to collude. I don't know how many of you do real price shopping when you get your airline ticket. We are dominated by huge corporations. With all respect, Todd did not answer the question. Even without regulation, it's the natural tendency once money emerges in society and competition and private ownership for aggregations of capital to grow. We can wish for a small anarcho-capitalist world of Adam Smithian interchange. If we had one, it would morph into the world we have today. So then the question is, what kind of vision can we have to enable us to have a sustainable future? A sustainable future is one in which we put different principles before us. I don't think this is going to be easy. On most days, I'm kind of a pessimist. I actually believe we are going to destroy ourselves as a species, to be completely honest with you, because I think it's so deeply ingrained. And unfortunately, the philosophy, despite the good intent, the philosophy that these gentlemen are advocating happens to coincide, dovetail nicely, with the interests of powerful corporate interests.
It should be noted, historically, cartels break down. They try to collude, but each person who's a participant in the cartel has a huge incentive to say, oh, you know, we agreed we'd all charge $10, so we'd make a lot, but, you know, I think we can do it for $8. Why don't we undercut the other guys in the cartel? And it disintegrates. So how do they prevent it disintegrating? They turn to government, which I'm not in favor of, to pass a rule saying no one can charge a lower price, nobody can engage in predatory pricing, or nobody can break up this union or monopoly. It's government that prevents the normal market price process of destroying monopolies and cartels.
Last point, because we're over 6 seconds. It has all, in my view, it strikes me as what would be called Manichaean. It has a wonderful cohesiveness to it, similar to like a fairy tale. Everything good is over here. It's called private initiative in business. Everything bad over there is government. If something bad happens in business, monopolies say, had to be government screwing things up. The environment, had to be government trying to create a rule to protect the environment. It's this default response to pretty much any problem. Maybe every disease in the world somehow will be government. Maybe we'll find that out.
We
cure
them faster without government.
There we go. So pretty much everything is government.
Anders, I would like to start off by asking the notion of private property. When was there ever an agreement in through contract or any other agreement between people that this piece of land is going to be mine, that's going to be yours, this one's going to be his, that this oil well is going to be mine. When was there ever agreement? And in other words, when was there ever just acquisition of the Earth's resources? John Locke says that you can only take so much that you leave plenty for others who come behind you, as good and as and cannot be. You can't waste private property. So when did this happen? When did we come to an agreement that private property is going to be acceptable behavior, as opposed to seeing the world as belonging to all of us and subject to all of our will, not just the will of the individual?
Sure. Well, there's a couple things. I mean, well, our point of view, obviously, is that people have not completely come into agreement, and our point of view is that that is part of the problem. But I think that part of the answer is that the obviously things have changed a lot now, but if you look at a traditional society, the people who have lived there forever, and it is their property. And then the historical evolution has been for many societies is that those people who have lived there forever, there's nobody else to contest the ownership. I'm sure they stole it, you know, millennia ago from somebody else, but they've lived there for a long time. And those societies agreed to carve things up, and those societies which did agree to carve things up and trade property amongst each other and give it to their descendants found themselves flourishing and having larger and larger populations and being able to support increasing population densities. And eventually those social systems, if we look historically, have overwhelmed everyone else. So I don't think that there is a agreement, but I think part of the point is that if you look at the transition point was not, nobody got together and had a worldwide congress, obviously, because that's impossible, two millennia ago. You couldn't all fly somewhere and agree on it. Is that each individual, the people in their area had to make social agreements as to how they were going to deal with things.
Was it a state that decided that the Native Americans would have to go, and in order for the our private property system in this country to be established, was it the state that determined that, or was it the desire and the will and the, of some who had more power? Which is the, you know, this is the real problem with any competitive system. Anybody who has more power is advantaged by having, advantaged in a competitive system. But was it the state or was it the desire and of poor people who were being denied opportunity in England and Germany and so forth, that was it not the everyday people wanting access to resources?
I don't understand the question.
Was it the state or was it people who wanted to remove the Native Americans from this continent and replace the Native Americans with themselves?
Well, it was clearly both. And if you look at American history, you can see that, well, one, the people who came over did come from oppressive systems, and they carried those oppressive systems with them. And you can also see that, I believe, around 1800, most Americans lived within about, 50 miles of, navigable water. And there was a lot of, the land was taken by stealing from the Indians, but a lot of the land was also taken by trading with the Indians. And a lot of the Indians did, in fact, stay.
Like Manhattan.
Yeah, and a lot, well, not necessarily Manhattan. I don't know I can't tell you which parts of land were traded or which parts were stolen. But it's certainly the case that both happened, and a lot of Indians did in fact intermarry and basically become, what we call Americans. And so they adopted that social system, and that social system within, the 50 miles had a much higher population density, and then absolutely the, U.S. government and private citizens did engage in what we consider unethical behavior, and we also consider that anarcho-capitalist. The land should have stayed in the hands of the Indians unless they wanted to trade it. And they wanted to allow people on their land who were foreigners, and the same thing goes for European history, so that where the feudal people didn't give them the right of conquest to go ahead and lord it over the peasants. We don't believe that. We believe quite the opposite, that the peasants' rights to their land and their community should have been respected, and they should have been allowed to evolve in their communities how they want to.
Well, it would be a real question to me to figure out who in, among the Native Americans decided that they would be willing to give up some of their land.
Answer.
I mean, that would be a really interesting question.
Would you like to answer that?
Pardon?
Would you like to answer?
If you know.
Sure. The people who lived in their communities and who lived on that land from time immemorial, they were the ones who made that decision.
We don't know that was done collectively, and among Native Americans whose attitude was a cooperative, as much as possible cooperation, much more so than the competitive market system that you're promoting, should all Native Americans have been involved in deciding what would happen in this country, which, you know, this was a massive genocidal action. So, and the vast majority of it, you must know that the vast majority was not given over. Oh, sure, take this. We'd like to. I mean, 99% of it was stolen. And so
we're anti-theft.
Yeah, we're anti-theft. Right. So we obviously agree.
Okay. So what then does the libertarian position do to rectify the stolen property, the stolen labor of the African population who were stolen out of Africa?
Okay.
What is a reparations for that?
Well, there are two sides to that. And this is a hard question, but in my opinion, there are two sides. One is that for reparations is that the people and descendants of the people who actually own the land or were stolen from should go find the people who own the property and try to get it from them. But it's going to be a lot of court cases because it's going to be very difficult to figure out who those people are. But that would be
relying on the state, right?
Not necessarily.
Well, you said there are going to be a lot of court cases.
Well, court cases can be conducted in private courts as well as or you can even say a historical investigation. Okay, let's have some people get together, look at the documents, and I don't know, an academic could say, okay, well, this is what we conceive from the historical record of who owns this piece of property and what happened, or it doesn't have to be a state institution, but a similar kind of function. And then the flip side of that would be that in a lot of cases, these problems are insuperable, and it's a big mess. Most people, I think, live in areas where they conquered it from somebody else, and we don't think that's a good thing, but that's the reality. I'm sure 99% of the people in the world living today are there because their ancestors conquered it and took it from somebody else, and it's not clear that you can give it back. So our vision, though, is that under an anarcho-capitalist system, there will be room for everybody, and so all those real existing people who actually do live today will have the ability to prosper, and people will want to freely cooperate, just like immigrants come in and are able to find ways to make a really good living in a lot of places. There's two ideas.
Why not just have it declared that the Earth's resources belong to all human beings, and let us now again. Yes, I know you can, but it will require cooperation. It will require that we are in agreement that that this is the way to move forward.
Sure.
But if we're not going to agree to that, maybe we need to divide the world in half, and you run your world the way you want to, and let the other half of the world build on a cooperative level.
Okay. So our point, and Todd was making this point earlier, is that that's actually what ultimately happens, is that, in fact, we don't even divide it into two halves. We divide it into 7 billion halves, one for each person. and each person runs things how they want and then freely cooperates. And we're saying that it's impossible to have a consensus among 7 billion people. The knowledge problem is insuperable, which is each people have their own particular perspective on things, and so having a consensus when done that way is impossible. But instead, we are saying that there should be cooperation, and that that cooperation happens through the price system and also the transfer of knowledge of each person from their individual perspective.
I think your turn. You're up.
Zach Zimmerman.
I'm just asking questions.
Just being playful.
One basic one. I get the impression from reading the Zeitgeist manifesto, the Zeitgeist movement defined, or at least one of their manifestos. I don't wish to say that that's the whole story. It sounds like Zeitgeist really does think that not just capitalism with all its details, but competition is destructive. Mm-hmm. Do you not find yourself having the everyday experience of lots of good ideas coming from competition and people saying like, our project is lame, ooh, look, they're doing better, maybe we should make more of an effort? Isn't that just a kind of a normal everyday part of life? Doesn't competition spur greater accomplishment all the time in almost every area of human endeavor?
Absolutely. Competition is a part of human nature. It's not the only part, though. There's actually deep social and cooperative instincts that we have as a species. The problem is not the abstraction, competitiveness. It's the link of that particular motive, and ultimately the reduction of the human experience to that motive, to an economic system, which I don't think either of these gentlemen are really thinking in systemic terms at all. It's just like some idea we're all individuals broken into these little units. The fact of the matter is these institutions exist and they have their own imperatives, and when you have to compete to survive for your livelihood, you will maximize profit at all costs. And if it's cheaper to dump your waste in an ocean, you'll do so because you're trying to provide for your children and you're trying to provide for family. You'll rationalize it, you'll narrow your scope. And unfortunately, the whole perspective they appear to be offering, I hope I'm wrong, is one that essentially justifies and buttresses this entire thing.
Isn't it the case that one of the simplest, most direct, most immediate ways to send people a signal that like you can't put garbage there is to have someone whose property it is? In other words, aren't you more likely to get garbage in a valley no one owns as opposed to a valley that someone does own and perhaps wanted to post guards around, you know, patrol the drones or post security signs around? I mean, you don't find a whole lot of garbage. You find garbage being dumped in unknown gullies.
Yeah.
You don't find big piles of garbage being dumped in the middle of shopping malls. Isn't that because they're private?
I think the principle of having your own property, I mean, this is a modification of what Harry may have said earlier. I don't see it this way. I think that is clearly going to be the case. It's not the question of property. You'll have your own home space that's not going to be taken from you. So sure, I agree with that. That's not a problem. The issue is, who produces these things? On what grounds do we produce them? And can we sustain a system that is dominated by profit-maximizing aggregations of capital? I believe, and I think the scientific evidence overwhelmingly confirms, that we can't sustain it anymore. We're all kind of living, kind of having a party and putting our heads in the sand because we all got to make a living, but it's simply not going to be sustainable in the long run. We have to start rethinking these things. I don't claim to have easy, pat, wonderful solutions, but abstractions like competitiveness, sure, part of human nature, sure, having your own home, won't get dumped garbage in, but the really existing capitalism versus the one you guys are advocating has enough plastic in sections of the ocean that are destroying coral reefs. Like I gave this statistic earlier, 58% of wildlife is gone in the last 4 decades. This is continuing. So yeah, it's being dumped into the global commons, all of our externalities, and it's not sustainable.
Might the problem be the commons? In other words, the degradation occurs in places where there aren't clearly defined property rights, so define the property rights more clearly.
We'll divide all the ocean up, into little quartiles, and everybody will own it.
Historically, there were effluent rights into different parts of rivers, and you couldn't just dump anything you wanted in rivers. It was actually the government that came along and said, it was the government.
It's not profit maximization. It's not the goal of a system
right.
that coerces us, essentially, to have to make a living by selling our labor. None of that stuff.
Stalin certainly still had filthy industries, and he was not thinking like a profit maximizer.
You're not going to get an endorsement of Stalin.
Right. Okay. So the problem isn't profit maximization. It may, in fact, be commons. A commons gets treated like crap.
Not
commons gets dumped upon.
Not in a direct democracy. Not in a direct democracy.
Well,
where the people rule over their commons as well as What's that?
Oh, we're going to have
yes.
I have more questions.
Come back in 40 minutes.
So, I, this is a problem. This is a question I just have for sort of social democrats in general, not necessarily specifically Zeitgeist. But, you know, Oscar Wilde once wittily said, the problem with socialism is all the meetings. And there is something to be said for that. I mean, is everyone going to become competent on everything? You don't think maybe the person who owns the steel mill might have a better idea how to run the steel mill and so forth? I'm reminded, there was a professor of political philosophy, wait, was it Judith Sklar? I forget now. One of them at Harvard was actually running a seminar on social democracy. And for the first time ever, she was late for class one time. She came running in looking all exhausted and sweaty and said, oh my God, I'm sorry it took so long, but we were voting this morning, and so I was at the polls. There are all these referenda. I can't keep track of them. How do they expect anybody to know all those different referenda? She's an expert. Do you really think 7 billion people are going to keep track of like how to run everything from you know, bicycle manufacturer to which art, I guess, gets subsidized and permitted?
We're at a moment in history where we can move toward harnessing our technologies in a direction that actually liberates us from the need
exactly.
to have to be meeting.
Exactly.
Basically, if we have our basic needs met, you can go and you can actually get access and you're not stressed out every single day worrying, as we all do all the time, do I have a job? Will I get a job? Can I keep my job? I can't cultivate parts of my character. If I'm interested in music, good luck at that. How are you going to survive and pay for your kids' college? We're forced into this narrow perspective that apparently they're calling freedom, which I would call a jungle, when we could be liberating these technologies so that people can actually have access to their basic needs. Of course they wouldn't have to meet all the time. Should you be interested in meeting, however, society would certainly embrace that. Should you be interested, maybe you're, I'm not on the techie side, ironic for a Zeitgeist person, but there's lots of people on the techie side that would be contributing to doing things more efficiently, more capable, harnessing direct democracy under existing capitalism, which they still have not responded to, is what their ideal capitalism will morph into. History shows that. It's dominated by powerful interests who are at present curbing even our ability to vote in this highly impoverished democratic process. So we're very, very far from anything even remotely close to democracy under this form of capitalism. I'm not saying Zeitgeist and harnessing collective technology guarantees some utopian future. I just think it's our only shot.
Isn't it frequently the case that with any political movement, they'll just sort of claim, like waving a magic wand, that, oh, don't worry, the airplanes will be better, the food will be better, the paint will be perfected, as it says, it literally says, in the science fiction-like final section of the Zeitgeist Manifesto. Doesn't every movement say, don't worry, it'll all be better? Where on earth is your evidence that the Zeitgeist mechanism automatically produces improvements in all these things when, if markets cannot? You know, I mean, like I'm sure the Fuhrer would say, if I were in charge, all the books would be better.
Yeah. Because things are being produced not for personal gain and private profit, but for public good.
I would respond, I'll give just one example to try to respond to that, which is how many of us in the room, and I know many of you are anarcho-capitalists, you may disagree, but how many in the room would prefer that when you go leave tonight and you want to look something up on Wikipedia, you'd actually prefer to put your credit card in, because you're on Wikipedia and you got to pay for it. Maybe it's by word, maybe it's by minute. Wikipedia at present has about 14,000 people freely giving their time. Something that, say it were owned by, and I'm borrowing this idea from Paul Mason in his book, Post-Capitalism, if we're owned by, say, Amazon, and then they had a hierarchy, because that's what capitalism is, gentlemen. It's a hierarchy. Critics will call it a tyranny. You have to enter into the work world to meet your needs, and when you're in that work, that job, you have to follow orders. Time to lean, time to clean. So I guess for people in the audience, you prefer, you don't want to have, you're oppressed by the freedom of Wikipedia. I would strongly disagree. That is, I think that prefigures possibilities of liberating technology across the economy in ways that could. I can't guarantee, Todd, I wholeheartedly agree with you. I cannot prove there's a passage in that book that says some kind of Shangri-La perfection or something like that. I would staunchly disagree with it. I actually think it's not tremendously likely. Harry and I had a little disagreement when we were putting this together because I wanted to put that this Zeitgeist economy is not likely. And he said, well, come on, we're fighting for it. Don't say it's not likely. I'm pretty pessimistic on it. I just think it's our best shot. We have to support it.
Interesting, by the way, that Wikipedia was created by libertarians.
Yeah.
Good for them. If that's the case,
well,
good for them.
But it made a good contribution.
Isn't a huge impetus to create things that people will actually enjoy trying to achieve customer satisfaction, and you're more likely to know you've done that if they're still willing to pay you. Isn't it the case, if you've ever worked at a lazy business, that once they stop worrying about customer satisfaction, once they stop worrying about whether they're losing money, once they get a big grant and aren't going to think about it for the next 3 years, they tend to get lazy? I mean, like, where is the evidence people think more about how to keep all those individuals happy when they cease caring about whether those individuals are still willing to pay?
Maybe in the rapidly discussed diminishing economy that's not dominated by huge corporations, that's the case. In real roles of real workers in the actual economy, if you choose to actually sociologically investigate them, people will say all the time that businesses give strategic disinformation, even retail workers. I know they can't share even the most basic information with their customers because they know their boss is over their shoulder, so they mislead customers. Capitalism is literally systemic dishonesty wrapped in a kind of entrepreneurial idealism. There's example after example. I actually no time to show it, but I have a page here of just one company, one GE's malfeasance during a three-year period. And I'm picking on GE. It's case after case after case after case. And of course, you gentlemen would disagree with that. But our point is not that we morally critique it together. Our point is that this is what capitalism becomes. You gentlemen think somehow it can be contained, that private markets and exchange don't morph into something larger. History has shown that's not the case.
I recall that back in the 60s at Columbia.
I don't mind if you finish it. We all agree.
The anarcho-capitalist economist David Friedman, son of Milton Friedman, notes the amusing anecdote that a lot of people at Columbia in the 1960s decided competition and capitalism are equal. And so one thing they did was ban advertising on the big student bulletin board. They weren't going to have any more businesses or entrepreneurs post items there, and they were going to have a simple font like Helvetica or something. And then lo and behold, one by one, all the leftist groups started deciding, well, you know, our meeting's a little more important than the other one. So the feminists thought maybe we can do boldface, and then the socialist group thought, like, maybe we can do italics. And sure enough, they kind of replicated advertising, and pretty soon the signs were becoming blue and louder and more exciting. And, you know, it's just not clear to me that these communes and collectives, any more than like the Brooklyn Food Co-op, are going to suddenly stop taking an interest in trying to secure the largest audience or customer base possible. And that might actually be when they're at their best.
Yeah.
In the realm of ideas, competition should never stop. Should always have competition and deep and as hard and as far as we can do it tonight. And so, and especially political speech. So it's in the realm of economics where we must learn to cooperate. And then, and you wonder about the time that we have. We will have plenty of time to govern ourselves, to go to meetings, and we don't have to go to all the meetings. We just have to be civilly involved in our community and to watch over what's happening. And all these externalities will not happen if we are, one, having a system that actually takes care of us, that is concerned about us, and that we know we're in charge of, and then we'll have we will not throw garbage into the commons. We will recycle it, which is the sensible thing to do. Have we gone through?
Yes, it's question and answer.
I think we're on the Q&A.
Do you, Mike, or one of you gentlemen want to take care of that?
Who wants to go?
Do you want to go?
Yeah, absolutely.
We've got two more hours.
Fine. If you don't
want
to go, I'll take
I can get 2 hours easy.
I need a question from somebody, so.
Yes.
I got it first.
Okay.
Have you ever heard of the enclosure movement?
Yes.
There were commons. They existed for a long time. They decided to make it private property. Mm-hmm. Those people could not support themselves. They had to work in factories. Mm-hmm. Capitalism is based on coercion. They moved of their own accord.
Their land was stolen.
That's how people went to work for factories. Because that was voluntary?
Right. So you're saying
that was not voluntary.
Okay, time out.
And capitalism from then till now is not voluntary.
I'm gonna state real quick that if we're gonna do questions and answers, we need to have questions, concise, and clear, please.
You're interrupting me.
Sorry. So if you have a question, please. Now, would you like to respond?
Yeah, I think I get it. Right.
So follow.
So there are numerous cases historically where things that sort of like the left praises, I would say, are actually the institution of property rights, and things where conservatives of the Tory sort might praise are actually aristocratic violations of property rights. So, for example, I'm not going to defend every kleptocratic regime in Latin America that might go through and say, we're going to machine gun you unless you get off your farms, we're seizing all this. And likewise, if those people have been farming that land for centuries, I might well approve of trying to carve it up into private property, but that doesn't mean when you do so, it then all belongs to the lord of the manor, as opposed to being distributed amongst the people.
Just did, that's all.
Right, which was terrible. Likewise, I mean, I think Czechoslovakia sort of handled the transition from communism relatively well, at least in that, and are doing pretty well now, in part because they decided, like, well, the fair way to do this is instead of just having a haphazard handing over of industries to, you know, cronies of the president, everybody in the entire country gets stock. So now you can trade it and sell it and buy it as you choose. That's a recognition that if this was, in theory, a collective resource, the next step, if you're privatizing, should be everybody gets a chunk of what was once a collective resource. So not really in favor of enclosure the way it was done.
Similarly to what happened in the former Soviet Union.
A
disaster that emerged there.
This gentleman in the white shirt.
Okay, so this is kind of for the Zeitgeist guys. Yeah, I'm a bit of a capitalist, so you guys might not like this question. So overall, just looking at this, I kind of have been hearing you guys talk about, I guess I'm going to try and talk louder. And I'm just going to go through my own personal background a little bit. My background is product development and trying to license inventions to other companies. So with that, always show up on time for meetings, always try and get everything delivered on time. Always work hard. I have another project, which is just a hobby, beinglibertarian.com. I don't even edit my own articles. I write them at 2 in the morning for fun. We have somehow 170,000 followers on Facebook. I have no idea. And quite frankly, my effort in that is very little, and I have no desire at all to make money. So don't you think that's me, case in point, trying to make money from one project but not trying to make money from another project? Doesn't that kind of prove that your methods of people just doing things because they feel like it, or there's some directist democracy construct, isn't that just, quite frankly, a bunch of bullshit? Like, don't I kind of prove that you're wrong?
That's the biggest non sequitur I've heard in a long time.
I'm on pause.
So you're living in a system where you have to make a living. That system compels you That system compels you to have to go to work, which is essentially a hierarchical structure that you work for. Do you have a boss or no? Sort of hybrid. So the bottom line is you're not a free agent under this libertarian capitalist system, right? You're something that I think is very important
to
libertarianism.
Work.
Even in the best case scenario, and maybe this is the best as it gets, many of you think it is, even in the best case scenario for their ideal utopian libertarian capitalist dream, the vast majority of human beings sell their time, which is a third or more of our life, to someone who tells us what to do. That does not ring very free to me, especially when we have the technologies available to us. If we harnessed it democratically and began to think a little more rationally, instead of so narrowly assuming we have to have conditions that exist today. Can you imagine in prior societies that the triangle slave trade was 300 years? Slavery went back thousands of years. If you said to someone, oh, by the way, we live in a society where human beings aren't owned by other people, they would laugh and scoff at you. Construct of the free person is ridiculous. Well, the construct of a free society isn't ridiculous. We're seeing actually intimations of it. Thanks to some really insightful libertarians who helped form Wikipedia, we know that we can start producing without being hamstrung and tied in by profit. Let's get there.
90%, let me just a quick response. 90% of America works for the other 10%. The question must be asked, is it more free to work for someone or work with someone? Working with someone, in my mind, is far superior and real expression of freedom.
Can I get a quick follow-up? Let's just say one of the products succeeds, something works out. How much money should I be capped off from making? I mean, is there money in your society? Because I will not work. So basically, I just do stuff because it makes other people feel.
If we weren't living in a world with ecological limits, I would love to be able to say everyone can be like a little baby grasping, and the only reason we act is to accumulate. human beings, children. Anyone who has children knows that children go explore the world. They expend tremendous energies creatively without having to be linked to a wage contract. So yes, it is a limitation, which I will concede. In a Zeitgeist economy, not everybody can fly in Learjets all around the world. There are going to be limitations, but the difference will be it will be collectively determined through a democratic plan, not rationed by who happens to have money, which goes, and the deeper you go back in history, it's linked to theft.
Okay. Okay, we're going to move on. You next. Yeah.
So you guys have covered a little bit the issue of a post-scarcity society. I just want to, first, just a point of clarity. Are you talking about technology becoming so productive that really we want for nothing?
As close as we, obviously it's never going to be perfect, but we try to approximate.
It's not going to be 100%.
Okay, because my perspective here is that if you were to, because this sounds a little bit like the concept of the singularity, if you were to go back in time from the perspective of a caveman, their desires relative to ours were completely limited. We live in the post-scarcity society compared to them. As things become more productive, don't our desires scale with that? Won't we still have conflicts over resources and need a way, I think food prices, to determine how they are distributed? This issue that we have, you know, limited resources, that things aren't sustainable, how can that go away in the face of human beings desiring more?
Well, look, the way we see things in the Zeitgeist movement is that there is a central, and this is why we have to work together as a human species on economics. And there's a central economic system. And the purpose of that central economic system is to see to it that supply is enhanced and need is being, or the supplies that we need are there. And then seeing to it that the localities get the resources that they need in order to decide for themselves what they want. And so it would be on a more local level that people would decide how they'll use their resources, what they'll do with their resources, and does that answer your question?
Sort of, but how do you determine people's needs, and who is deciding?
Well,
you know,
if I could just give a concrete example today, you take like a corporation like Nike. Nike spends about $14 billion a year just producing things, $3 billion of which is pure advertising. So from a Zeitgeist point of view, it's largely a waste of resources meant to manipulate the public mind.
I mean, if you don't
get
know
children,
about the shoes, how do you buy them?
Okay. Advertising is about informing us of the product. That's about 150 years out of date view. Massive amounts of resources are molding public interest in alignment with a competitive system. Is it a part of human nature to be competitive? Of course it is. But it's one part. It's not the part we should be celebrating. We have cooperative instincts that we have to start cultivating, and we're not going to do that in a system like this.
Okay. This gentleman, and then we're going to go to you in the back.
I was glad to hear about this debate tonight, and I was coming here expecting to find common ground with a group called Zeitgeist, which was very appealing to me, and finding the anarcho-capitalist to be completely utopian and unrealistic, and my expectations are completely wrong. I can't believe the history you've cited of American Indians doesn't at all jive with the Indian tribes, Indian societies I've learned of in New York State particularly. There was no idyllic peace or United Nations type of resolution construct for Algonquins versus Iroquois. They were deadly enemies.
They were infernal.
Of course.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Do you have a question?
Yeah, and I'm just asking you, unto themselves, you can't tell me they were anything but fiercely competitive with each other, and they had absolutely none of your Zeitgeist ideal in mind. So I see it's a nice, interesting discussion, but I don't think there's any precedent in Indian people in the United States, and the idea of white people as oppressors, very simplistic.
Okay, I didn't hear a question there, so I'm going to move on. you in the back, sir.
My name is Connect 6, and I'm actually a friend of that guy, Charles. I'm very familiar with Zeitgeist. I've seen all three of the three movies. One thing that concerns me is I'm aware of your association with the Venus Project, which advocates for the advancement of society through the elimination of money, the elimination of currency, and then through labor we get to dice and spheres and things like that. So, okay, so if you're telling me that
no, we're not going to actually, there is no real argument that argues that we develop faster or more efficiently. I'm missing the pitch. Why is your system superior to the one we have now that does produce supply, that does produce seemable progress? Why would your system be better?
So the question is, why would a resource-based economy be superior to the current system, correct?
If there are limitations.
Because it's based on cooperation and the need of everyone, not the private profit and need of specific individuals who have managed for however they managed to do so, who gained power and control over others and use that power to keep other people from getting, keeping them down, really, in terms of education, terms of health care. This private system of competition is a system that's designed to work against the vast majority. In a system of competition, you have winners and losers, and most people are losers. Mm-hmm. And that is the way that the competition works. I don't care if you got a state or you don't have a state.
No.
Should we allocate every woman here to each man and share
that?
That is just not necessary. No, no, that is not necessary.
All right, there was a question here in the front.
Okay, Professor Carson, you used the state of New Jersey as an example of the malign influence of corporations and corporate entities.
And then here, Dr. Cason.
But you used the state of New Jersey as an example of the malign influence of corporations. How do you reconcile that with the fact that under pretty much unfettered capitalism, New Jersey had a thriving economy, it had flourishing bedroom communities and growing cities and an expanding tax base, whereas under the less capitalistic, more interventionist central planning model you seem to favor, it has hemorrhaging population, it has declining cities, the people are moving to other states with less regulated markets, and corruption is so endemic that it's been labeled the soprano state. They have a public pension system that's so out of whack that the relocation of one billionaire throws their state into turmoil. You have to rewrite the budget.
Your premise, I would fundamentally disagree with. First, maligning corporations? I have no interest in morally condemning corporations. That doesn't make any sense. I'm addressing the systemic reality of what a corporation is. It is a money-making machine. It's like a shark. It has to continue to accrue profit because it's in a competitive system. No matter how well-meaning and morally righteous the people within it are, they simply have to continue to reduce costs at all costs. And that leads to destructive outcomes. Is there a history in New Jersey of those societies that jumped on the bandwagon of corporate power and benefited from it? Of course. Capitalism has been the greatest productive machine in history, far better than any prior social system. Clap, clapping anarcho-capitalists. But guess what? This weird non sequitur that you guys have. Okay, it's been the best, therefore history ends now. I mean, let's start looking at the scientific facts, people. The system is no longer sustainable. We have one planet. Read any of the World Wildlife Federation, Living Planets. There's so many environmental organizations. I guess it's a big conspiracy. Maybe they're funded by feminists or something. The overwhelming number of scientists in the world point that we are living in a world of ecological limits. This is a hierarchical system. It's not a free system. We may not be able to be liberated through a zeitgeist economy. I don't have the same degree of confidence that Harry does, but it's our best shot. That's how I'd respond to that. So I would agree, it was better. I have no desire for state interventionist approach within capitalism.
Based on endless consumption. Endless consumption. This system, that's what it's based on.
Would the anarcho-capitalists like to respond to any of this that you've heard so far?
I just say briefly, I actually want to apologize to corporations for part of my earlier remarks, which may not have been clear enough. I was condemning them for trying to form cartels in which they use government to enforce monopolies. But I should make it very clear, no objection to corporations simply making their customers happy, and that is how they go on making money most of the time, is by saying, oh my gosh, we could lose all of our customers at any moment. You think corporations are heartless? Look at customers. They'll disappear on a dime if they don't like your products anymore. Corporations are constantly asking, how can we keep all these people happy? That's why capitalist societies are so much happier than socialist societies.
Whoa.
That's wildly problematic.
Yeah,
fundamentally not true.
That's
social democratic societies, Denmark, Norwegy, Sweden have the highest happiness.
Right. So Scandinavia.
Now they're capitalists now.
All right.
Consumer.
Let's try to keep a little order here. Okay. Anders, why don't you go ahead and respond?
Right. So 2 points to that. One thing is that Scandinavian countries actually have extremely strong free enterprise systems, which is why they are so rich and why they're able to afford such big welfare states. So that's how that works. And then on the other side, it should be noted that corporations they have to serve their customers. So yes, people who work for business have to be in a hierarchy, but the people who work in the business, they have to serve their consumers. So that's actually the root of the hierarchy. And everybody ends up running around trying to serve each other's customers. So it is true that a lot of people don't like that system, and a lot of people don't like having to serve their customers. But I agree that there are issues with that, but I think that has to be kept in mind, that's the root, and that those organizations which don't serve their customers go out of business, which is a good thing, which is that they disappear.
Right. Okay, this gentleman back here in the back. Right.
I have a question for the Zeitgeist gentleman. I'm more interested in the theoretical principles that would drive the society that you advocate for. I'm going to set forward an example, and then you don't have to tell me what is the solution to this problem, but I would like to know what kinds of principles you might use to try solving this problem. So if I invent a bicycle, who gets the first bicycle produced by the democratically elected factory, or do we create artificial scarcity by not giving anybody a bicycle until we get enough bicycles to give everybody who wants one?
I have
a
response, but if you want to hear it.
If
would compare it to a family. Family buys something, there's lots of children, you have a democratic process. Someone's going to use it the first day, someone's going to use it the next day. I don't see it as a very vexing problem.
Right. Okay. You had a question.
I just quickly wanted to respond. I think that would lead to a coercive situation if people are being democratic in a household, especially like the oldest, biggest kids would naturally overpower the smallest kids. But anyway, it seems like you guys don't like hierarchies, and I don't understand why. And in your society, there supposedly is no hierarchy, but who's running in the machines, who's developing the machines, where is that coming from? 90% of people can't really do what the top 10% do, I think, in my personal opinion. And also, what is the standard of living? Is there an average standard of living? Because if there's an average, there must be a hierarchy,
We haven't mapped it. The Zeitgeist movement hasn't mapped a perfect social system. It has some principles that it believes through democratically harnessing our technologies to produce en masse could liberate and have lots of people with access to lots of stuff. The first part, we don't like hierarchy simply because we like freedom. And we don't like to be told what to do. We want a world where we don't have to be anymore.
And so in the society where we have direct democracy, we will decide, young people might do some of the things like delivering pizza, but then they will go and do other things. In a Zeitgeist world, job rotation will occur quite frequently in lots of different places. And hierarchy is an expression of domination, and so I would not want to continue on with a hierarchical system and with a direct democracy system. That's the very point: is to have everyone participate who wishes. Now, I'm not going to force you to participate, but anyone who wishes to participate can do so. And it's not hierarchical, it's a collective decision.
What if it's a collective decision at first, but then people decide they no longer want to be part of the collective, and the entire collective decides we don't want to do this anymore? What happens then?
As I said, if we had to, we could break the world down in two parts, one Zeitgeist and the other libertarian. I would hope that would not have to be. I think that if you saw the advantages of cooperation, where you are able to participate, You are being protected. You are being included. You're being. You're not being excluded. The issue of education and healthcare. All these things are no longer a concern. Now you're in a position to worry about higher order things.
The issue of what would they do? I mean, what are they doing now? Mass populations living in inner cities that have no job prospects. They get warehoused in prisons. I mean, people don't have freedom to choose to negate capitalism right now, and it's still existing. So maybe there'll be some people in a zeitgeist world who say, I don't want free access to sustainable goods. I want some alternative system where I'll have to work for someone to obtain that. I mean, it's like, through our thought experiment, this may be our last comment for a while. Thought experiment, 300 years if we don't destroy ourselves as a species. I'm hoping for the day where people say, because I'm a teacher, I want my students to say to me, I'm living 300 years from now, you're telling me 300 years ago there was a tiny group of people that owned all this stuff called money and property? And the vast majority of people, because they couldn't get access to goods, had to sell themselves and reduce themselves to objects called hands in the 19th century just to make a living? That's so unattractive, it's hard for me to imagine people gravitating to a system of relinquishing their individual liberty.
They had to work for someone else.
Now before I go on, Anders, Todd, do you have any thoughts?
Quick thought, which is that people did move from agriculture and having to be serfs, and I think that you do have to work for someone else in the sense that you are serving a customer, and I think that is and then that is part of it. And I also thought it was interesting, the idea of job rotation. And I'm also actually very happy that I'm not being rotated into your guys' jobs, because I think I've failed miserably as doing professors. And so there's a lot to be said for division of labor and people being experts at doing their own things.
Dave, you're free to do.
This gentleman in the glasses, sorry. Rebecca, yes, green shirt.
Quick question. I've heard a lot about the coercion in capitalism. I'm wondering how we're going to create a zeitgeist system without coercion. And then how do we deal with people who don't like the decisions of a democratically decided situation?
So there would be some coercion. You can't build a system without coercion. There's no way to build a libertarian society without coercion. And the reason being is if I disagree with the idea that I have to live under a competitive world where most of us work for someone else, and I don't like that, and I don't want it, then it means I either accept it, or I have to leave and go to some other, I have to go out and live in the wilderness.
You in the bandana.
There's so many contradictions in what you guys are saying, my mind is blowing, so I'm going to try to focus on one, because it keeps moving along. You keep saying how you hate... You don't want to be told what to do. Do I look like someone who wants to be told what to do? But why is it somehow better to be told for 49% of the population, be told what to do by 51% of the population, than it is for me to say, okay, well, I'm not like being told what to do by this douchebag, so I'm going to go over and see if I feel better work for this douchebag. No, I don't. Well, maybe I'll try to serve my fellow men and work for myself, not have to be told what to do by anybody. Why is that not a better, more free situation to live under, so long as I'm not harming or violating anyone's rights, than 51% of the people saying, no, you cannot take that bike that you bought to work because that other jackass took it and he wanted the bike and there's no other bikes left. Why is that better?
Do you think it's realistic that we can all work for ourselves?
Yes.
Yeah, but really?
How does that work?
That wasn't the question. That was not the question.
No.
The question was having a choice of whether I want to work for douchebag X, douchebag Y, or take the risk involved in serving my fellow man and work for myself. I have choices there. I'm free to choose. The other way, you're forced. It's not, the one's not coercion and the other's not coercion. One is voluntarily choosing and the other one is coercion.
You know, both of them are coercion of a sort. I would rather be coerced by a democratic plan where I get together with other people, because in this world, you know, food and things aren't going to fall from the sky. There's going to be some degree of scarcity even as we move beyond it. So of course there's going to be some element of that. But your position of working for yourself is somehow not coerced. You have to produce within what is socially profitable, which is constantly getting reduced in cost because of the power of machines and automation, creating tremendous insecurity. And I would argue, and I can't prove it, and you guys are going to scoff at it, I would argue that this competitiveness, which is the one side of human nature that is the only one you guys see and celebrate, is corroded by a system that we have no sociological appreciation is historically specific. We universalize it. We live in it. We assume it's the only way to organize society, and it narrows us and it reduces us, and we end up advocating positions that seem like all free choice, when in reality they're very narrowly scoped.
You and the tattoos, you have a question?
And the tattoo, yes.
Sorry, that's what I said. I'm like the black shirt, the cat.
My only question is, if I don't feel like participating in your democratic process, do I still get the benefits of it?
We believe there'd be enough resources if we reduce things rationally and humanely and sustainably.
And would you really want to live off of other people's work and labor?
So the point is,
we work together, and we're all living off of the work that we do together.
I'm just not being on meetings.
Well, you wouldn't have to. You wouldn't have to go.
And the notion that laziness is the human condition, were it not for me.
I mean, I'm not lazy.
No, I know you're not. Yeah. I would be, though. You would be. If things are free, I'm just going to louch at everyone.
So, like, scenario. Let's say Europe in pre-Columbian times converted to Zeitgeist, and maybe the whole Eurasia. And then, 200 million Europeans, or even, like, 500 million Chinese, discover America that's underpopulated by a few million Indians. And what do we do with them? We tell them, guys, you are underutilizing this huge landmass which could house, and they're obviously not ready for that because they are fighting among themselves, so do we put them into some re-education camps?
No, you work and ask if you may, can we use this? Is that, and work with the people who were there.
But who gave them the right to own this huge part of land when Chinese and Europeans are crowded?
They don't own it. They have access to the resources that are provided by Mother Earth to human beings.
So
we move
100 million Europeans, or 200 million Chinese, and push Indians aside because they are obviously not efficiently using the land. Right?
Well,
so how would we fare better?
Are we using the land efficiently today? I think we're, as has been pointed out, we are destroying the land.
We have Zeitgeist in Europe, but Europe is small and has 200 million people, and American plains are huge and have few million Indians. So how do we repartition that?
I love these concocted philosophical examples. We have population issues in the world. That's not our main ecological problem by any stretch. It's the organization of our economy that is ultimately driving these fundamental economic stressors. Population is an issue, though, and a mature conversation about how much population we can have, I think, is something we need to recognize. Now, what that would be, what human beings would come to agree upon, is something in that future, or I guess it's some past thing.
How would they resolve it? How would society resolve it?
People are being born in the world every day, they're engaging each other, and the deepest principles of respect for each other would have to come into play.
So what would prevent Europeans from moving
to
America?
We support the non-coercion principle deeply, we just don't think it can be done in capitalism. We support them here. We would say we can't roll over them.
You would have to be willing to work with the people, the native population who's there, and see in what way you can help them and how they can help you. You don't just go in and, as we did, and steal their land.
But they are they're using all the land that's owned by everybody on Earth,
and they don't want us there. And if we can show them how they will benefit by working together with us, then we'll all be better off.
I guess his implicit point is, if you don't start from the assumption that the Native Americans own the land, they may get steamrollered for socialist reasons as easily as they might get steamrollered for supposedly capitalist reasons.
That's true.
It's possible, but it would not. Well, let me just say, it's possible, but it would not be in the vein or the mode of practice of the Zeitgeist movement.
And we, of course, don't think it's in the mode of practice of anarcho-capitalists, too.
This is where we all agree.
I'm curious how your
respective systems would address climate change, which I heard it described as a massive market failure. I have a response.
Do you want to go first?
Do you?
Okay. Yours probably will sound, in this case, more mainstream. So why don't you go first, and then I'll
The only, I would argue, you don't have to agree, obviously, I would argue that we have no shot of addressing climate change under the existing capitalist power structure. Profitable institutions, not because they're bad, evil people, I'm not interested in maligning corporations or the people in them, profit institutions have to keep making money. So then they're going to find the 1% of scientists who say, oh, we need to be tentative in the trends. And they're going to listen to them. And they're going to feel good about what they're doing as they're advocating and lobbying for political policies that keep a high fossil fuel and fracking industry alive. So the system of competitive capitalism where you have to keep people consuming all the time just to be able to keep the jobs cannot possibly work. Now, it's possible, not probable, Harry thinks it's more probable than I do, that if we have a rational system where scientific voices and communities get together, harnessing our technology, we can then start actually asking the question, do we have the resources to continue a fossil fuel economy? Yes, it does mean we have to step down and say, okay, maybe we don't need every single person with an automobile. Maybe we need to start thinking about monorails and thinking about public transportation. Of course we have to start talking about these things. So I would say the Zeitgeist economy, a democrat, radically democratic system harnessing our technologies around sustainable, scientifically informed understanding of ecological limits has a much, much greater chance. And this is another interesting question. How do we even start moving? I fear with the libertarians that the worst possible, they don't intend it, I think they're very well-meaning, but they're against crony capitalism and the state on behalf of the public, right? But in practice, what their point of view is only going to end up doing is eliminating protections for the public because the powerful corporations are going to get their way anyway. So that's, I don't have a perfect map for how it would be done. I just think Zeitgeist is the best chance.
It's a complex problem under any system, but I think the two most interesting brief points, at least I would argue, under an anarcho-capitalist system would be class action suits. For one thing. So even if you had no central government telling you what the levels of gases to be emitted could be, you could still take major polluters to court and or anyone else producing damaging externalities, such as people spewing garbage onto your lawn, and say, you know, you've done X amount of damage, even if it's in the billions or trillions, and you're going to be sued and lose a whole bunch of your money unless you come up with ways to prevent doing that. The second part that's also sort of an interesting thread is I would contend the best way, if you want high technology to solve problems like dirty fuels being used, the best way to solve that quickly is to make people as rich as possible very quickly. And a lot of people on the left, especially the environmental left, don't intuitively believe that's the case. They tend to think that society keeps getting dirtier and dirtier. In fact, if you look back like the Middle Ages, they weren't living in an eco-conscious way. They were doing things like burning down whole forests for warmth and for light. And the more rich you get, the more you can entertain other ways of doing things, like using tiny, tiny amounts of aluminum in cans instead of really thick keg-like cans like they used to have. Some people in the crowd are old enough to remember when they weren't paper thin. So the faster you get rich, likely the faster you're going to find something like backyard fusion reactors being physically possible. So wealth and class action suits, sort of my two-part answer.
I would also add to that that the anarcho-capitalism solves the economic calculation problem, which allows society to most efficiently create new technologies, and it also allows innovation, which creates qualitative leaps, which is what you need to get things like, you know, backyard fusion reactors. Yeah, and it will also allow you to have fuels which use less and less carbon and maybe more hydrogen or, you know, nuclear fuels for fusion or fission reactors, as well as it allows innovation, which allows more solar panels, which therefore allows you to have 7 billion people who don't starve.
Yeah,
we have plenty of time.
Harry, did you want to say anything?
Yes. it is really technology that enables, not getting rich, it is technology that makes the possibility of solutions to problems. Well, money doesn't do a thing for you. It's knowledge.
Correct.
And education in a Zeitgeist world is free. Now, what, a court? We're going to go to a court? What court are we going to go to? There are no public courts. There are only private courts. You want to sue me? I don't want to go to your court. I don't like your court. I got another court. But if you'd like, we can go to my court. How you want to do this? How's that? And I know these people. So.
And systems like that have existed. And if you refuse to submit to arbitration, then you can be arrested.
By who?
By who?
My private security guards.
Oh,
okay.
Or more security guards.
It's often worked that way in the past. It worked well.
Yeah, hops. I read him.
I just got thrown off at that.
I wasn't pointing to you.
Both libertarians and the Zeitgeist movement used to believe in this thing called peak oil. This is back in the days when oil was trading at about $150 a barrel. Basically, they lowered the mileage of the cars because they improved the technology of the cars using the current system that we have. And as a result, nobody's talking about peak oil anymore. I just don't see any real scarcity. I think the technology that you're describing is being developed. And I think commodities prices going down is evident of that. So why do you believe that there's all this scarcity that the market and I don't see?
In the case of fossil fuels, we're not talking about scarcity. The fracking has been absolutely devastating. We're continuing to do it. Fossil fuels in general are unsustainable. If one particular fuel happens to be slightly better, according to some economist metric, I would give thumbs up to it in the immediate run. But in the long run, we have to get beyond a fossil fuel economy. So I would strongly recommend. Afterward, I can point to a whole array of ecological literature. You can dispute it and say it's all conspiracy, but I can point you to a whole bunch of scientists around the world talking about what we're doing in terms of climate change and a whole concatenation of other ecological problems associated with that.
So
kind
you
of
recommend nuclear power?
Okay.
I'm open to other things.
I think maybe scarcity was getting used in three different ways there.
Yeah.
I mean, so, oil might decrease over time, but before that we were using scarcity in the more broad economic sense of having to economize resources because they're not infinite. So that might be too complicated to untangle in a one-minute response. Maybe we should move on.
Yeah. You would get to ask your question.
All right, Professor, after hearing your idealized image of the Native Americans freely using the resources of the earth, what I want to ask is, have you heard of the Beaver Wars? So I hadn't until recently, but that was Iroquois Indians fighting other Indians over control of resources, the resources being fur-bearing animals. Now, do you say that's a demonstration of capitalism in operation? Do you say it's the fault of white people for creating the market?
It certainly isn't Zeitgeist working,
that's for sure. No, it certainly is not.
Is that a question
for
the anarcho-capitalists?
I want to say
it's
something.
A question mainly for the Zeitgeist people.
Oh, okay.
Now, quite seriously, and you make the point as well, you've made the point that the Native Americans did fight among themselves. That's true. But they internally were much more democratic than we are, and called for democracy. So that people can fight over things. This is the choice we have to make. If we make the choice to be competitive about it and not share the resources that are available, then we will fight over it. That's the whole point of the Zeitgeist movement, is to put an end to all this massive killing and dying and control of resources by the few who just absolutely refuse to share the earth's resources, and they have 62 people have more wealth than the bottom 3.5 billion. This was not an accident. This happened through competition. This happened through murder, stealing. This is the nature of competition. And yes, if you want another world, it is going to be one where, yes, you don't always get what you want in a Zeitgeist world, but it's a world that's based on working together and cooperation is the goal, not competition.
You will be next, right after this gentleman who's been patiently waiting in the back.
Be quick.
Zeitgeist folks, I just have a question. Where did the people who practice the fine arts fit into your society? How does that function? Since they don't, the non-applied arts, so if I want to be a painter or something like that, since it doesn't contribute to the, like if I'm an engineer or something.
That's outstanding. They're liberated to actually be able to do it. To today's society, the first thing I ask my students, what are you studying? And they give me their answer. I say, did you choose that? Well, not really. I wanted to be an artist.
Mm.
But I can't be an artist because I have to translate my human energy into a marketable commodity, which, by the way, is unsustainable. We'll put that aside. So under a Zeitgeist society, when we put aside maximizing gain. This very, it's a part of human nature, to be sure, to be status oriented. But let's not celebrate it, people. Let's start recognizing that it's antiquated, and let's get beyond it, so that the arts and games and a flourishing of the human condition can unfold.
But if you put up something like, say, a niche aesthetic taste like comic books or punk rock to a vote, it would be destroyed. I mean, there are only about 4 million comic
fans. I don't know why it would have to be for a vote.
Yeah,
there's going to be rules. There's going to be rules. It's like you go to a library now, which is a poor example, by the way, of what we're talking about. But if you go to one, it's like there may be some limited access. Your book might not be there. You might have to ask for it. There's going to be some limitations to exactly what the conditions are to make your comic book. But the thing is, with commuter-aided design and everything else, we're churning these things out basically. But doesn't cost anything.
But I mean,
close to nothing.
I don't see any reason for it
to be limited.
In a market, all you need is your customers. You don't have to ask the rest of the population. You don't need 300 million people to be on your
side. In a market, you need the capital to be able to invest, and you're competing against other businesses that can undersell you
in
increasingly unrealistic ways.
And in Zeitgeist world, you have the access to the resources, and the most important aspect of the Zeitgeist world is freedom of thought and expression. So there's no problem there at all. So
the blue shirt.
Yeah. Okay, back around the horn.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Look, there will be questions. The way the world is organized today is in corporations, large assemblages, organizations of capital and people to get things done. Everybody with me so far?
Yeah, I'm with you, man.
There are, you know, plenty of, you know, little enterprises.
We're with you. We're with you.
In the stasis.
Okay. The question.
Not every single one, but certainly in this country, who makes the decisions for everyone who works in that company? It's like a board of directors, a CEO, or whatever. Small number of people. Now, do you think they care about customers? They got their money made 10 times over. It doesn't matter to them.
They don't feel anything.
You talk about competition, they don't feel competition. They get their golden parachutes. They got somebody who wants to change the law. They want a judge. There are a limited number of judges who are going to find against them. This is, read the newspapers, okay? Why can't we start, instead of like transforming the whole world, let's transform a few corporations. Did anybody ever hear of the concept of consent of the governed? Is that anything so bad to institute in a corporation? Move towards that. You think they would vote to move their jobs overseas?
Fair question.
Yeah.
I just said, do you think they would move?
That's a good question.
Democratic decision-making within corporations?
Yes.
It is
up to the owners of the corporation if it happens to be...
He's not going to give it up. When does power give up power?
I mean, there are firms of more distributed ownership, and if they vote to keep their operations here, more power to them. But again, we would obviously say it's up to the owners now, whether they're numerous or few. And
that's the problem. It's all about owning.
No, that's the beauty. That's how
that's
you get.
Beauty.
That's how you get responsible.
Limited number of people
that's how
having
get,
power over as many.
Everyone
as
getting everyone getting distributed power instead of some big communal group telling the marginal people that they have to play along. Should we move on to closing statements?
I didn't know we were having any.
Well, yeah.
I'd rather.
We
don't you guys rather do questions?
We have 8 minutes.
We have eight. We can have 8 minutes of questions.
Unless you guys
have
We have.
There's so many questions. They don't care about us rambling more.
Half an hour more?
Can we say we said 15 minutes?
I can stand
too.
It's
15
minutes of questions. Is that what we decided? Is that what I heard?
We're going to do, what we're going to do is 8 more minutes because we have that left on this card. And then we'll go to closing arguments. We're going to go back around the horn. So, you, sir.
Okay, so throughout this whole little thing here, I've had so many questions that I think we could still be here all night. But we're not going to be here all night because we have limited time. So my question is going to relate to...
We can come back tomorrow.
Limited time, limited resources.
Yeah, no, so I'm going to actually make this question relate to resources.
You guys have numerous times said we're running out of resources. That's simply not true. In North America right now, where we have free market lumber, or basically free market lumber with the property rights, we actually have more tree space right here that's being used better. When it comes to oil and energy reserves, we bring up the price of oil. We've done horizontal fracking, which has taken a bunch of North American stripper wells and made it so we don't have to dig new wells. Wells and they work more effectively. Also, we have nuclear power, which is regulated. So, can I just ask you, what have we run out of? Because with copper, the market prices during the initial, the 20s, and then we replaced it with fiber optics. So, what have we really run out of in an actual supply and demand property rights system?
Well, we can produce a lot of things. There's no question about that. Capitalism can produce a lot of things, but we have to ask the question, what are the results of what's being produced? Fracking is an absolute disaster for America in terms of earthquakes and destruction of water tables. So the question is, why don't we get on to solar, wind, and geothermal? Why don't we get on, which is clean and free? You know why we don't? Because of corporations. Because it's free. Because it's free. And because it's corporations standing in the way. The oil, gas, and coal industries.
I want a little bit of clarity on some of the terminology you're using, because I have a definition that I think what these mean, but can you tell me a little bit, I'm sorry, I'm very bad with names.
Harry.
Can you talk a little bit about what direct democracy actually is, as opposed to, is it 51% versus 49%? What is that? And for you, sir, what precisely do you mean by sustainability?
Okay, direct democracy is a system, particularly at the central level, where anyone who wishes to participate is able to do so. In terms of deciding how what they will do, those who participate will decide. Now, if the wider community sees a problem with what a certain group has done in a certain area, then that wider community can come in at any time and overrule. There would be plenty of referenda. Now, I would say that we're working on a cooperative basis, so we're going to really push hard to find a consensus, something that libertarians think is impossible. Now, I don't think that we can get 100% consensus. Of course not, but we will build much more. 49-51 is not a consensus. I don't think it's good enough, and that's, of course, the way we do it in this system now. It's not good enough to make decisions. We have to build a community and find where the problems are and what is causing someone to resist to work with us and solve those problems and that would be my direct democracy, at least some of it. I mean, there's more to be said, but...
I would just briefly add to it. It involves democracy not just in the voting booth for preset candidates largely funded by powerful corporations. It would be democratic decisions within an economic industry where people are cooperatively gathering and working together. Would it be 51? Would it be 71? Would it be supermajority? Would it entail certain fixed rights? I can give you and say, okay, there'll be 10 fixed rights like the Bill of Rights. I mean, there's going to be some cocktail of those things. I want to advocate some principles of sustainability, which brings me to the second part of your question, that we need, which certainly entails radical democracy, but it's going to be up to mass publics in the context of what I would expect to be some pretty severe crises down the line. And the way we're responding to crises right now is not healthy. Look at the election season. We're responding in a xenophobic and very dangerous way. And I think that's linked to mass stress, mass economic insecurity that we all feel, feeds into this anger where we scapegoat people. Sustainability is using resources in a way that does not jeopardize future generations' capacity to have those resources. Some call what we do now intergenerational tyranny.